Well, let's call the meeting to order.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to its republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Chairman, I move to adopt the agenda with addition of number nine and other business, the BLM problematic environmental impact statements cooperating MOU.
I second that.
Motion second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Approval of the minutes, February 21st.
Mr. Chairman, I move to adopt the minutes from the January 21st, 2023 meeting.
I second that.
Do you need to sign or do I have to sign? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Ben's good. Brian, move the phone over here.
I'm good.
Hi, Brian. This is Tom Ryan. How are you?
Well, not too bad. How are you going?
I'm good. I'm good. We're in the commissioner's meeting with Connie, our new admin. Have you met Connie?
I have not met Connie yet.
Well, you're in for a treat, so.
Yes.
Commissioners are here. County attorney and the clerk are here. The newspaper, some visitors. So.
Great. Maddie is not feeling well today, so she is out. And she was also out of the country for the last 2 weeks. And so not too much was done, but just kind of the general, what we've been doing, we continue to do that. So she's continuing to work on scanning the septic permits. So she processed and uploaded the septic permit files from the 1982 to 1983 cloud storage, added septic permit information to the online GIS database, and then also we've been working with Shane on the Samsung Galaxy tablets. Just discussions with him, reached out to Esri, verified that the tablets are going to work for field maps, and I guess that at this point, we're just going to kind of continue on what we're doing, which is, processing those septic permits, supporting road and bridge, and, when they get those tablets, we might have to make a couple modifications to meet the requirements of the tablets, but so far, everything that we're looking at, those tablets should work just fine. So that is, kind of the update, the short and sweet update this month.
Okay. So are we still planning on an in-person update in the second Tuesday or third Tuesday in April?
Yeah. So that is do we wanna get that scheduled right now?
Yeah, why don't we in that, you probably something besides just an update, we probably want to be starting to look at what budget for next year might look like as well.
Sure.
What the plan is and where we're where we're headed, but that we could do that all. You know, we usually try to schedule those as a work session before the
meeting.
Yeah, before the meeting on the second meeting, which
is that the 18th?
18th.
The 18th, yeah. So it'd be the 18th. We could just do it at 1 o'clock.
Okay.
If that works for you.
You want to schedule an hour?
Yeah, you know, an hour or an hour and a half. You know, if it goes a little long, that it probably wouldn't be the end of the world.
Sure.
You know, sometimes those get a little more involved because we have questions, and you know, it's like, oh,
sure.
Look how cool that is. So,
right.
Anyway,
okay.
All right. Well, we'll plan on the 18th, at 1 o'clock.
We'll reach out to Shane and to Bo to see if they want to meet before or after that meeting, so we can make the most of our trip. But so right now I have on our calendar from 1 to 2:30 to meet in person for a GIS update.
Okay. All right. That works for you guys.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think Brian, bring your computer and we'll put the. Project down and we'll work on that on our big screen down here so that we can just become a little bit more familiar with that. More of the same discussion about what's public, what's stays for county use, and all that, what you've been doing. So,
sure, yep, okay, we'll be prepared to.
Okay, sounds good. Thanks, Brian.
Thank you.
You bet. See you.
Operations, two twin-engine turboprop airplanes, two single-engine turboprops, three twin-engine pistons, two jets, four turbine helicopters, and 88 single-engine pistons. So, made for a pretty good February that way. Two air ambulances, six airplanes stayed the night here, and we had two requests for a hangar. They're both small airplanes, but still requested. Fuel sales, we sold 1,267.57 gallons of AV gas and 2,417.17 gallons of jet fuel. We're selling a lot of that 307 Aviation out of Orland right now for whatever reason they're filling their chase trucks. We have a couple of kids in the area doing some flight training, so they really kind of boosted our numbers for this month. Doing touch and goes and stuff, so it helps for this time of year. And lastly, I'm still waiting on a quote from Steve for the replacement water pump. But, I mean, what I got in there. I did try to go down and measure that building and almost got stuck, so we had to take the next time. The warm weather's going to help us, but that crust, boy, once you get it in, it's all sugar underneath it. You're there. Yeah. I got the top truck stuck at the end of the runway a couple weekends ago. I thought I was going to walk over the back because nobody was around. But other than that, that's all I have for you. Do you guys have anything for me?
I know you talked to you saw an email.
Yeah, I replied to Carson, and my only concern is if you let him move out, he'll leave a void there. And the only thing, you have to wait for somebody that wants to build that size. Otherwise, if you put a smaller one in there, you have dead space. And as we all know, that paper costs a lot of money, so.
Yeah, I've had several conversations with him, and I guess in the master plan, it says me, so.
Yeah, but they're not surveyed. you know, that's the only thing I'm saying. Like, if you go to Worland and look at their hangar situation up there, they have stuff in the middle and stuff that doesn't work and taxiways to get around here and there. So if it's not, you know, if you skip that spot and then he builds his 60 by 60 or whatever he's building, and then the guy wants 120 by 120 or something, you know, all the way down.
Then you have a bad spot.
The last guy's got to go back to it, so. I don't care.
Okay. I don't.
Development's.
It is. And you want to encourage him to. But I don't disagree with your, you know, he wanted to split one, and I said, no, we're not doing that. So anyway, okay.
All right. And Mr. Chairman, there's also I'm hearing that if there's weird lights in the sky and you want to know if there are UFOs, then you can call Mr. Messenger.
Yeah.
He'll give you an astronomy lesson.
Hard rice.
I don't know if that's a service, but.
It's free.
My phone number. They were bright.
Yeah. Well, it was Venus and Jupiter.
Sure. We're right there together. Yeah.
Yeah.
Barbara Rice called us. Like, there's two lights out of here.
What is that?
It's not a pillow.
They were pretty bright.
Yeah. No, it was pretty neat, but it was an interesting phone conversation.
Most everything with Barb is interesting.
Okay. Thanks, Nate.
Thanks, Nate.
You're welcome. You guys have a good day.
Yep.
Thanks.
See you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, February didn't disappoint as far as the snow goes.
What didn't?
We didn't let up yet, so we just continued with our regular snow removal of this winter. It's been busy. A lot of work on some gravel roads because of drifting. It's been pretty bad. Fire number checks are done. We plowed the old runway for the state park driver training. I think they're actually doing that today. Winter equipment maintenance continues. We've been checking culverts, making sure there's no obstructions in anticipation for this runoff that we're going to be getting. I got a feeling it's going to be pretty significant. So we're just trying to get prepared as best we can. We cleared snow out of the parking lot over here a couple of times and examined it a few times before. As far as stuff from last month, I met with Dean and our clerk about the tablets. Dean came up with a recommendation for a Galaxy tab. And we sent that information up to T.O. and Maddie kind of looked over it, and she thinks that.
We talked to them this morning too, so. So your tablets, they think the tablets are gonna be.
Yeah, they said the only thing is a lot of them, the search engine is usually pre-downloaded as Internet Explorer. They said we'll probably have to change that to Chromebook or Firefox just to run the system. But other than that, it should be good. She said there has been some things where they've had problems with the GIS running on an Android tablet, but where we've already had some Android devices using it, she doesn't foresee a problem. And she said if there is a problem, that's something they can change on their end pretty easily, just a couple clicks.
Okay.
The cost on those, we're looking at $279.99 each, but we do not have to have them hooked up to a monthly plan. So that's just going to be a one-time cost, and it'll be done. And then Dean was recommending a $40 fee for some cases and protective screens for them, being that they will be out in the field. So we're looking at a total of $1,279.92, and that would be for the four tablets, and you get them all set up and ready to go.
Okay. No reason.
That seems like the best option. We did look at some iPads and stuff, but we're looking at $600 to $800 a piece for those. Just don't think it's worth it. I actually came out and visited with Quentin about it, and he kind of took me through what you guys had, and it's almost identical to what this is, and I think it'll work really well for us, the size and everything.
Yeah. We've had good luck with those. So
yeah. That's the same office that we use in our trucks as well.
And indeed, the big question was whether they'd be GPS capable, because they have to be for that operating system. And Dean said, as long as they are cell phone capable tablets, you don't have to have the cell phone hooked up. As long as they're capable, they have the GPS device. So,
okay.
And that is all I have for you, Jordan.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do. We do have a right-of-way permit for these are signs for the Grass Creek Sunrise. They don't have it on here. So it just says Grass Creek Guest Ranch. These signs are being actually provided by YDOT, so there will be no cost to us, but they will be located within our right-of-way. So I've looked at it. I don't see a problem with where they would be at.
Okay.
They're all going to be out there on Grass Creek. So.
Yep. Until Grass Creek changes to a county road. Obviously, YDOT's part of this process, but they have their own process for putting up signs as well, right?
Right. Only one of them will actually be located on YDOT. The other couple will be on the county road. So they're basically just guiding signs to steer people so they're not turning off on the wrong roads out there.
Okay. And YDOT's furnishing the signs, huh?
YDOT's furnishing the signs and the posts and doing the installation.
And they're installing. That's nice.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I move your signature on the Hospital County Right-of-Way Permit number something, Sunrise Guest Ranch, for the three signs and their application fees paid.
I second the motion.
I move motion to second. Any discussion?
Stop for me.
Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any roads drip clear shut or?
Buffalo Creek did once. Jack called me that morning. He's like, "Hey, we can't get in, we can't get out. It's completely closed off." And I said, "Well, I already got people heading that way, so we're good." So they weren't there long after. But
unfortunate, we're not in other parts of Wyoming.
You get on the other side of that canyon.
It's amazing, isn't it?
And I think we've had wind this year. Holy cow, they've had some wind over there. Yeah. It's been crazy. So we've actually been pretty lucky. We've had a good amount of snow, but
it's melted.
Yeah. We did have some pretty major drifting out on Lower Cottonwood. It drifted about 5 foot deep across that road there. But we were able to get it opened up pretty quick and get people through. The farmer that lives out there, he had ran his tractor through, so he had a little lane through there, but that was about it.
Did you have to take a cat to Buffalo Creek and push it?
No. Yeah, we got it cleared with the blades, but it was a process. And then we ended up having to take the dozer out there and push all that snow back to give us room in case we got more, so we had a place to put it. We had pushed it back with the blades previously, but it just kept coming and kept coming, so we had to fire up the old dozer and put it to work for a little bit. So,
yeah.
guys.
Thank you, Kim.
Morning.
Good morning.
Morning. We had a boiler problem in the courthouse area that we kept popping off. It was getting too much pressure. So we put a new pop-off valve in that. Everything's been working 100% fine since then. We got lucky and found one within 4 days. The heat exchanger for the public health here has finally been put in and installed on the 16th. As of the 9th, the compressor for the IT room is still 2 weeks out. I got an email from him today, said he got a bill for it, so it should be any day, so hopefully we get that put in next week or two. The generator went down on the 27th here. We had it fixed on the 3rd. It was the igniter switch went out on it. We're still having problems with it. They're coming back to look at it later this week because it wouldn't start again yesterday on our test.
The Generac here on the
roof? Yeah, on the roof. They're thinking part of it is the fuel of the regulator is not regulating enough fuel to it now. It's only like 8%. They want 12 to 14. So I got the gas company hopefully coming out this next week too, to leak that.
Instead of jumping after gas.
Yeah. I just figured something like that. I should have put that in there, but I didn't. Generator update for the detention center. It looks like it's being shipped 6/8/23. We did get parts for it already. We couldn't get into our mower shed to put it in there. We got stuck, so we just put it in the Sally Port for right now until the snow gets pushed out of there, or we get a little less. The duct work that's been on hold for a year and a half or so over in the extension office 4-H building is done. It passed all tests that they ran on the 2nd. Everything should be ready for the summer for them now. They put new duct work in, new vents, everything's bigger. So hopefully that's done.
Okay.
Les had a meeting at the fairgrounds on the 1st. I have no idea what's going on with that building. He hasn't got back to me on that one, so I don't know for sure what's going on. We got our pump installed on the 27th over in the library, and also an air handler motor, which has been sitting at Jayco for, I just found out about it once. We got that installed at the same time. We're still working on getting the air pushed out of the system for the library, but everything's up and running over there. And the windows on the 516, I'm sure you guys have seen it, the abandoned buildings have been falling out. We finally got some wood ordered through John Dorman. This is the lumber yard here. We're gonna pick it up, I think, this week and get those blocked off on the inside. Right now we've got a piece of paneling board that we found in there to put it up there, and it was all wet and moldy, so hopefully we'll get that knocked off this week, if not next week.
Okay.
That's about it.
Okay. Thanks.
Thanks, Frank.
Thank you.
Where'd Barb go? Otherwise, you'd have to bring it.
She said she was tied up in court. She'll be back. So if her trial comes up, she'll come back later. If you can skip over her for now.
Okay.
Still available, but we have seen an increase in the prenatal classes that people are requesting and the visits that we're doing. So I'm doing that. I think it's important for our team. our PHRC just went to a training for advanced PIO, the public information officer. So now she's one out of four in Wyoming for that certification. Our immunizations, just a little snapshot. The last quarter, we ordered 115 doses of publicly supplied vaccine. We didn't have any wastage. We're doing a lot of sharing still with surrounding communities, so we don't have that wastage. But we have expended 96% of our vaccine line item for this budget. So I would like to be able to purchase more vaccine out of my total budget, if that's, if you guys are fine with that. A lot of it went towards the changes in the recommendations for the adult pneumonia vaccine changed, and then with the change of the high dose flu recommendations for 65 and older, those two things have been 30% of our budget, and then the cost of vaccines just came.
No way, that's gone up too.
Imagine. Yes. And I didn't have a magic ball when I was calculating the budget for last year. If you're fine, if I just use my overall budget, there's a couple lines I can take it from to continue to purchase vaccine.
That'd be a question for our auditor.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I'm wondering if we ought to do something like we do with Fund 30.
An enterprise account for vaccines.
For the fuel, you know, the way we buy fuel. It just seems crazy to me that it generates all this money and then we have to sit here and wonder if you can buy a vaccine, which, you know, it should be self-funding basically. And I don't know, you might look into that and see what that might look like.
That makes sense. To me, how about to you?
Well, it is kind of almost the enterprise, but a revenue fund in the sense that it generates its own revenue.
The other thing we can look at doing is when that revenue comes in, putting it back into her budget. Anything that's over and above. So we can look at different ways to do that too. And I'll talk to my auditors too. Then.
Okay. It's been a thing here. Well, you're out of vaccine budget. Well, the reason is because you sold tons of it and generated a lot of money.
Yeah.
So, anyway.
No, I think that's good. Thank you.
Okay. We, our children's special health services, we received one new client this quarter. That's the care coordination services that we do for youth children with special needs to help coordinate resources for them. It also can cover high-risk pregnancies and ones that are required to be prevention. Our next meeting is tomorrow at noon. And then I gave you guys a copy of our prevention needs assessment where Jen had broken down for Hot Springs County. There, I mean, you can, if you go to the website, you can break it down even further, depending on what you are looking for, but that's kind of the overall snapshot of Hot Springs County.
What do I have to do tomorrow to get functional
and that. Everything I have. You guys have any questions?
On the survey, I've been in this game for almost 20 years. How do they conduct that? How many people were in?
So they pull 6th grade, 8th grade, 10th grade, and 12th grade in the schools. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, you can go further into the, to the, if you go to the pna.com.org survey, I'm sure you Google Wyoming PNA survey. It's an outside entity that provides that to the school, and you can look at just 6th graders or just 12th graders, or there's a million ways to look at that. Yeah.
It's been a pretty accurate survey, so.
I mean, as accurate as the survey can be,
yeah.
We don't conduct it, so.
you. Bill, you're up.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Bill. Let's see. Saturday we resumed our monthly siren tests, outdoor lit siren tests, so they will be here on out. The first Saturday of each month at noon. Tomorrow, Wednesday, March the 8th at 5 p.m. at the Fire Hall, there's a meeting of the Wyoming Pipeline Association is coming to meet with anyone who wishes to come and learn who they are and what they do. Take part in that meeting. There will be food. So it's at 5 o'clock tomorrow. The snowtell trends continue up above in the drainages above Boyson. They have not leveled out at all. They continue to climb, and I want to make it clear there may have been a little bit of one person contacted me after the last meeting. I'm not implying that we might see anything that we haven't seen before. So if we do get high runoff this spring, it's not going to be anything that we have not seen before. All I'm trying to do is make those aware who may not either may not remember or may not have lived here during the last one, which I was just looking at some charts that I made back from the runoff in 2017. So anyway, I'm getting off topic here a little bit. I want to make that clear though. I'm not advocating that this is going to be some mammoth thing we've never seen before. The four snowtells that I watch up there are Hobbs Park, Townsend Creek, South Pass, and Deer Park. I've shown you charts of those graphs of those before. I'll just update you by saying that Deer Park now has 76 inches of snow and almost 19 inches of water in that snowpack. Snow water equivalent of 19 inches. So that's a large drainage with 19 inches of water that's gonna wanna come down. And Boyson presently is at elevation of 4716, which is about 9 feet below the full. So they have plenty of room to work with. I think, again, I'll say that my belief is that it won't take very long after the ice breaks up in the lake. And a little bit of water starts coming into the lake that we may see them increase releases to make sure they stay ahead of it, which they will. I have every confidence that everything will be fine from their operational end at the Bureau of Reclamation. They always have been and they'll do it again. Owl Creek is, the Owl Creek Snowtell is showing this morning, is showing 27 inches of snow and 5.7 inches of water in the snowpack. So it's looking very good. I think it bodes well for a good irrigation year on Elk Creek. We'll keep an eye on that one. Also a couple of documents. I just want to note, I don't know if you keep up with these, but these news releases from the Bureau of Reclamation, we get it each month, and they issue the snow melt forecast, and on their January the 13th
She said they're in our correspondence.
No, these are not. These two are not.
Oh, I'm sorry.
These two are not. I just printed these out because I just wanted to give you a couple of numbers from me here. The one that came out on January the 13th, they said that the forecast was for incoming into Boysen this year would be 550,000 acre feet, which is 91% of the 30-year average. In the February forecast, with the snowtails continuing where they are, now they are saying that the inflow to Boysen is 800,000 acre feet, and it is 131% of the 30-year average. So you can see they're watching it too, and they're aware, and they'll be on top of it. So, and that brings us to, I gave you all a copy. I sort of refurbished this whole program because I think we're going to be using it again this year. And I just wanted to make it in a presentation that would be, that you could see, since you're who I work for, and I want you to know what I'm up to. And if people ask, this is what it's all about, the County River and Stream Awareness Levels. And just know that after that 2017 year, which was pretty profound, in 2018, then I developed this this program, and all it is intended to do, it asserts no authority on anyone. It is simply informational, so that people have the information they need to make decisions for themselves. Safe decisions for use of a river, and safe decisions for homes and residences along drainages that may see flash flooding or flooding at certain times as we enter season like a spring like we're entering now. I think I think all of our streams that have misbehaved in the past, we may well see them misbehave this spring, just because of the snowpack that's up there and the water that's going to soak down into the ground, and if it gets rain or thunderstorms on top of it, we may see some high water coming down some of these streams. But this this information that's contained in this package here, Laura Love has agreed she's going to be running this next week in the newspaper, and then she'll run it again a little bit closer to the start of the actual runoff. The newspaper has always been happy to help out with this program, and you'll note these stream level awareness signs that go green, blue, yellow, orange, red. We are in green right now. I'll remind you that one of the goals I hoped we could get from these images right here is that people, as they read the newspaper, would get used to seeing a color for a couple of weeks or a couple of months, and suddenly the color would change and it would catch their attention. And the newspaper has always agreed to run a little article about why it was that we went up a level or down a level. You might call them criteria below each one, are really flexible. They aren't carved in stone. And if something new were to come up and we were in a level yellow, but some unforeseen action came up, we might, I might crank it up a level. But at any rate, that's the history and the current status of the river and stream awareness levels. As you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, I think in the last meeting, once the weather changes, we are seeing activity on that river like we've never seen before. And a lot of those people either are new here or are inexperienced floating the river, or are tourists coming through the area and have no clue whether that river is safe or unsafe. They just know it looks pretty. They don't realize it's cranking 8,000 CFS and it's very dangerous. So that's what this is about, and this will be getting used, I believe, as we head into spring. And I think that's all I got for you.
Thank you.
On the awareness level, do we post that at both ramps? Is there any indication that somebody's traveling into town, they don't have a newspaper and access to a newspaper?
No, if you look in there, if you look in at page two of it, you'll see the signage that goes up in the boat launch areas.
Okay, those do.
At 3,000, 5,000, and 7,000. Those just sort of worked out to be pretty good benchmarks for lookout levels.
And they're posted on all the boats?
Yes. Yes. Yes, they're posted at Wedding of the Waters. There's one at the 8th Street Bridge. There's one at the State Park Boat Launch, and then there's one down at, no, there's five. There's one down at Wakely, and there's one down at the end of East Sunnyside, down at Longwell's area. So there's five of them. And
who posts those?
I do. I put them up, I take them down, I change them, I run around like a chicken with my head cut off, with my step ladder, and my battery operated drill. No, I change them. And it's based on, because I get the water change orders from the Bureau of Rec to the dam, and as soon as I see those key benchmark numbers come up, I either start the signs or I change the signs.
Good, thank you. Have you ever used the Danger 300 yard?
Oh, yeah.
Have you used that?
Yeah, there's a picture of it in there, too.
I see it there.
It's hanging on the bridge, and it was there. It was needed that year. And I have to look to see what year that was, but most definitely, if you're coming down with a drift boat or even a kayak, at about 9,000, if you're coming down with a kayak, you won't get under that next bridge. So, it's time to get out right now.
Yeah, hopefully when you hang that sign, you're not hanging off the edge of the bridge to hang it.
No, I'm not. I got a process for getting that up all by myself too. But trust me, it's tied on to the bridge at all times until the chains are fully wrapped and on there. If it slips, it's not going in the river. So that's yes, sir.
I think we're definitely going to see high water. You know, I think some of the things that we haven't seen is, over there on the Tough Creek Flat and all that area, there's a foot of snow. You know, foot and a half of snow in Shoshone. It's like there's snow in places, you know, up at the head of Tough Creek that doesn't normally have any snow, and there's 5-6 feet. So,
Fremont County's kind of different looking.
Yeah, really different looking
than we are, and we have quite a bit of snow on the flat here. Mm-hmm. It's an unusual year for that. Spring will be beautiful and will be green, and we're going to look like Ireland for a while. But I think it's supposed to snow more on the high country up there in the Wind River. It's Wednesday and Thursday. They're going to get more, so they're putting a foot on, a foot at a time, and these storms are cranking through and dumping on that. On that particular range. And I was talking to my counterpart over in Sublette County yesterday, and all his snowtells over there are below average. The snowtells coming into Buffalo Bill are below average. If you go around the state, there's a lot of them until, as I mentioned last time, when you get down near the Colorado border, there's a lot of those snowtells up in that high country that are way above average, a lot of which flow the other way though, and go down across Colorado, won't bother us. So I really kind of think, in some respects, Boyson and the drainage is coming into Boyson may be a bit unique this year versus the rest of the state. We'll see.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Oh, you want to go
yes,
now
sir.
And then we'll come back?
I can do that. Good morning.
Good morning.
Gentlemen and ladies.
The Natural Resource Planning Committee will be meeting tomorrow night at 5:30 in this room. The they have several new topics to discuss this year, as we have a increasingly interesting federal regulatory situation. The NRPC is taking a closer look at some of the issues that are now being raised, and you may be hearing from them soon on some of those topics. It's going to be a good discussion.
What time is that meeting again?
5:30. Yes, sir. Heather Jones is the new chair, and they just last month appointed their 2023 officers, and I like Heather. She's on the ball. So this is it's going to be a good year. Land Use Planning Commission will be meeting on the 15th. They do not have any agenda items, but they want to discuss the or conduct a workshop on our procedures, our process, and in particular the checklist. I've got several fairly new members, and they are they want to make sure we're all on the same page, kind of hone their skills. That'll be a good workshop.
What time is that meeting, too?
That's at 6 o'clock on the 15th.
6 o'clock.
Yes, sir. The I don't want to steal any. I'm not going to steal any of Bill's thunder. He's running the Emergency Planning Committee. I will, however, when they meet, I believe on the 14th, I'm taking the minutes for that, and I enjoy being a part of that that committee. Very interesting dialogue taking place there right now. Very important. So that's on the 14th, that's during the day. Concerning septics, given the winter conditions, things are a little on the quiet side right now. I still have three unpermitted septic systems from last year that I know were installed without benefit of a permit, and continuing to discuss with the property owners, bring them into compliance. It is important because this morning, first thing right after I got here, a gentleman came in, had acquired some property. Septic system was built in 1987, and our records do go back that far, but he's looking, he wants to know where the system is, where the septic system was installed, and we have no record of it. We have no permit. It's not the end of the world. If someone doesn't have a permit with the county, but it's nice to have that information on file, because sooner or later someone's going to want to know where that critter is. Newer systems, it's easier to determine because of cleanouts and so on, where the location is. But anything that's built in the 80s, 90s, they're invisible. So it's a challenge.
Have you seen any activity from the Red Rim Ranch subdivision that are starting to see septics yet? I mean, have you started?
No, but I've talked with several people who are, several folks who are anticipating construction this year. So we'll see where that goes.
Yeah.
It will be interesting. We'll learn a lot about that part of the county. There was some discussion over the past month about the Arapaho Ranch and the trust lands addition to the Arapaho Ranch. Raises a question of what extent does the county get involved in responding to notices that lands are being proposed for trust status, and I don't know. I'm just throwing that out there. The county could, for example, be interested in the terms of leases, making sure that they're renewed. Those particular parcels, I think, are kind of non-issues, but it raises the question about in the future, as the as private lands in the county slowly dwindle, then. Does the county have an issue? I'm not inviting
discussion about that right now, but came to mind, it's on my list, and I have not replied to the notices about the recent transplants. Someone else may have. I don't know if that's really been determined as to who has the responsibility of a reply to this. Is it the commissioners or okay?
So
I'll let that ferment for a while.
Mr. Chairman, well, at the last meeting, we did talk about that just a tiny little bit.
Okay.
The state is looking at that. The state was working, the Attorney General's office was looking at appealing that.
Interesting.
And doing some work, they said that they were kind of late to the appeal process, but if they had something that they were going to prepare us to do, that they would give us a copy of that, so we could look at it and either sign it if we loved it or ignore it if we hate it. So I haven't seen anything forward from that. Connie, have you seen anything come up? So we're keeping a long distance.
I just want to make sure I'm not missing a stitch here. So if there's any way that my office can participate or respond, let me know. Our annual DEQ gravel pit report is coming up. I hate that thing. Shane's got a full plate right now, and what I did is a week or two ago sent him a copy of the last report. I need to get numbers from Road and Bridge and on gravel pit production, and then I will formulate them into DEQ's package and then pass that along. We've got quite a bit of time though to work on that, but I was hoping to get an early start this year. We got a late start last year, and when Shane gets back, we'll put this together. But that's hanging out there. Last item I want to run past you is just a heads up. At the end of this month, I'm going to take some time off from the 28th to the 31st. I've already mentioned that to Becky and Karen, and no one's chewed at me afterwards, so I think we're doing okay. My wife and I are going to take off and attend a conference that has nothing to do with planning. So I'm kind of looking forward to it. On the 22nd, it's coming up, 2 weeks, I have my annual with the VA, and so probably half a day that I'll spend down there and in Riverton, and that's it.
Okay.
Unless you gentlemen have any questions for me? Thank you. I'll see you in a few minutes then. Maybe I'll loiter
in
the back here.
Mark?
I'm up.
You're up? Yeah.
All right then.
I want to miss this.
You're popular today, Mark.
Oh my gosh. Go back. What is today? The date, the month, or the time? Oh my gosh. Hello, everybody. So, I'm really busy. I'm not just making that up, running back and forth. I have 16 total in program, 11 males, 5 females. 3 of those individuals also attend Hotisa with me, so I was trying to tabulate that up. I have 17 in class, plus 2 additional that had expulsion hearings, one of which is registered online, and we provide support for that and additional math tutoring over there, and one student that went back to school. But we still provide that advocacy and support over there. So grand total for me, if you take away 3, and that'd be 13, that'd be 30 people. I'm really busy right now. We did add a math tutor over at the classroom and that's been really helpful. We just find that math is just one area where people can, including myself, can use some extra help. Obviously, I can barely add to 30 this morning. And that has really been a game changer. Just having that extra support with the foster grandparent who can sit and help people with their reading tasks or whatever, and last year has been really good. The other thing that we added, we had our first group with Stephanie Richard from Health Center Behavioral Health for our kids, and we had 10 kids that participated in that, and we really had an hour scheduled for lunch and that, but it went hours. like, these teenager people would really like to talk more than me, imagine. I try to practice calm. I try to not offer anything to just say. We just have been busy with community service projects. The snow was a killer for us this last week. A whole lot of shoveling, myself included. We do the food trucks and that unpacking and all of that. And when we did that amidst the snowstorm, the ramp had frozen. The lines to the ramp that lets down so we can get the food out. We had to lift all of that food at two different locations over the ramp down onto the back of that truck. That was interesting. That was just terrible. And then we did the, my kids are just really invaluable in that. I just can't even tell you. Most of the volunteers are elders, older folks like myself, okay, senior citizens, and it was really hard. And those guys, we had a little refrigerator donated, and one of my kids hopped in the back of my truck, grabbed the refrigerator. It wasn't that little, like a medium refrigerator, grabbed it with one hand, leaped out of the truck with the refrigerator, and I thought, man, I need to retire. And then we helped with the pancake supper, and 17 of my kids came. I don't think we've ever really had that much help. They ate a lot of pancakes, but we had a group of 17 kids that joined with all of the other adults who were there, and it was really successful and wonderful, so pretty much that's it. Now I'm back to more trouble over there at court. Been running back to this camp question.
There's a fundraiser happening this Saturday at the BFW. The Rotary Club's doing the minnow races, and the benefits from that are going to go to help support the GG program.
I am completely out of the loop on everything. There's a fundraiser and we're not helping. What are you doing?
Minnow races.
I had no idea. Well, that's cool. We should probably show up. You know? is that Saturday night?
Yeah,
there's a deal. Oh, wow. Well,
some
that's
flyers.
Just...
There's some flyer that came out in the chamber newsletter.
I haven't.
Here, now you can be up to date.
Okay. Oh, that is literally can I have to...
Yeah.
Oh, that's fantastic. That's wonderful. We'll definitely come. Are we eligible to come in? Okay. Just checking. Oh, that's really, that's wonderful. That's awesome. Thanks so much.
If you've got questions about logistics or anything like that, please talk to Shree.
Okay, I will.
The Rotary meeting is today at noon.
Well, because I forgot on the 11th, we're also doing the rubbish sale to the church. I'm sorry, thanks for bringing that up. I forgot it. Well, you won't hear about it until next month. But we'll be all cleaned up by 4. Quick shower, down to watch the mental races. That's wonderful, and that is just really greatly appreciated. Thank you so much. You guys have been very kind about all of that, so thanks so much. Any other question? Anything else I need to know? Anywhere else I need to be?
Thanks,
I'll probably
thanks
be there.
Her.
Thank you.
See ya.
Well, let's jump down to other business. Ratification of Wyoming State Parks Historical Sites and Trail Assumption Risk and Agreement to Old Park County of Hot Springs County.
Chairman, I move our ratification of the hold harmless signed by Lieutenant Howell for the training that is being conducted today at the Pole Airport. No signature required.
I second that. Okay, a motion to second. They're just up using the old runway for training and
high speed maneuvering. Yeah.
Okay.
Around the cracks.
Is that, do they have like their gators up there? Or
the park marks are up there.
Okay.
I think that person had the ice training.
Yeah, ice training.
With snow. The good things she didn't plow that, you know, we're up there today.
It was deep.
The dogs just about
didn't hardly want to go. Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Two, approval of Carver, Florek, and James audit engagement letter.
So moved. I suppose the price went up.
That was, what, 3%? That was great. So last year when we got their bid, it was for the 3 year. And so it is the amount that they did in their original proposal. And that is attached to the very back. You can see the increase.
The audit cost is $49,955. Wow. That's crazy.
Do I second?
I second that.
Okay, motion to second.
More discussion?
I've heard very good comments from our component entities about working with the firm as well. So
I thought their audit was very professional and they did a nice job.
I was very pleased with it.
Me too.
Very pleased with it.
How does that typically compare cost wise?
That's very typical. I can't remember what Horowitz's last one was. I'd have to go back and look. But it's higher a little bit, but part of that was also because they're from out of town and Horowitz was not. So there's out-of-pocket expenses and added into that are figured into that. They don't bill us separately for it. It's all part of their audit.
It's also sort of frightening when we went out for requests for proposals and limited number that we got that were here close, and I was pleasantly surprised with them. So
and Jason emailed me and said that they've now hired another Wyoming individual. They'll be up in Cody to add to their Wyoming base. So
okay,
that's good.
All right. Any other discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
All right.
All right. Three, ratification of senior senator support letter for the SLID grant.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we ratify the previously autographed support letter sent on behalf of the senior center to help support their SLID grant application.
Okay. I second that. We've already all signed it, so other discussion? What was the application? Was it?
I was told they needed that letter by the first. She didn't tell the actual deadline for the application.
Okay. Okay. Very soon, if I was saying aye.
All right,
go ahead. Approval of senior center generic support letter for other grants. Okay.
It's basically the same letter, but not as specified to the SLID.
Okay. I assume they're probably working to try to raise money. Is this for their new building, new construction?
Yeah, she's working on several avenues, and so that's the reason a few different letters.
Okay. Do you have a motion? Do you have a second?
I second.
Okay. So any other discussion?
We need to sign this one already.
Yeah. Signify by saying aye. So, item five, approval of RFR number 1, 2023, NAVAID maintenance.
Mr. Chairman, I move your signature on RFR number 1, state project AHS026X. Total state grant amount awarded $4,754 for NAVAID maintenance.
I second that. A motion, a second. More discussion?
Have you signed it on black cap?
I have already, actually. Because if you don't sign it, then it ties it up.
And that invoice was actually paid in October, so that's why they went ahead and put it up. So
okay.
We didn't have to wait to pay before we asked for reimbursement.
Okay. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passes. Approval of RFR number 8, Black Mountain Road Project.
Mr. Chairman, I move your signature on RFR number 8, Black Mountain Road Project, for a total of $16,626 to pay 100% of the invoice to TO and then Whiteout bills Hot Springs County for our 15% plus indirect costs and a Whiteout labor charge.
I second that motion. Okay, motion is second. There was something we didn't discuss, I guess you saw on there, the update on the during change report that Black Mountain Road, they're continuing to do it. Some of the work they're waiting for the thing to thaw out a little bit so they can do some of that other environmental stuff.
Most of the geotech is down there working on design and environmental.
Anyway, it's progressing well. So I don't know if you remember the deal we made in order to get the $5 million from YDOT for that project. It was a program called the CRIP program.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually federal money, but it runs through the state. And what we had to do is agree to take over the maintenance of Grass Creek Road. So in that discussion, but in that, they will bring Grass Creek up to, they'll lay an overlay on it, clean the culverts, or if you need to do it, replace them.
I think cattle guard. Replacing all of the culverts.
I think that's what we decided. Anyway, and we don't have to take ownership of that road until they get all those things done. So those are actually in the STIP, like in 2027 or 2026 or something, so that actually gives us a little bit more time before we have to do it. But that was part of that. It was the only place we could find a chunk of money that.
So then ultimately, the paved section of Grass Creek Road will all become county road.
Yeah.
Yeah, after
right now, it's split between county and
first on the paved.
7 miles or 8 miles is. We had to try to find a road that was comparable. And we didn't want the other half at Black Mountain Road because it's a mess. So. That one has a lot better sub grade on it. Anyway, so just to understand where that money is and how that's all rolled together.
Thank
you. Discussion.
I'm keeping a spreadsheet of our cost of that. What are we in occupation? To date, you paid $39,286. Out of the
261 miles. Okay. Any discussion? Sure. Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I'll get you back sometimes. Those funds, county funds, coming from our county road fund maintenance that we have.
Which is, again, federal money that flows through the state.
Well, some of that money was, some of it came from the increase of the 10 cent sales or fuel tax that came a few years ago. The county gets, a couple $100,000 maybe a year to go into that. But anyway, that's what that line on is.
Chairman, I move Dwight L. Horak, number 7, for the TAP grant for the Children's Outdoor Discoveries Area, total RFR number, or dollar amount of $698.59. $558.87% is 80% reimbursement by YDOT, and $139.72 is 20%, which is reimbursed to us by BHB and BC.
Second?
I second that.
Motion to second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Just the one. Just the one that says. Item 8, discussion and possible action regarding the TAP grant for the old airport. So, Ardura sent us a note that maybe we would want to look at TAP grant, which is we just signed a TAP grant that we sponsored for the Discovery Center to do a study for their project, and was approved last year. And TAP is Transportation Alternative Projects. They ask if we might be interested in developing a master plan for our property up there at the old airport to of the trails. So how are they all going to connect? What might possibly be? How would we get access to the BLM up there? Some of the discussion that we've had with. People that were up here the other day, and they were around up there.
Yes, this is council.
WBC. So, and I said, wow, I can't believe I hadn't even thought of that, because I actually am the representative for the Commissioners Association on the TAP Commission. So I said, yeah, put it on there, and we will see where it goes. That's the reason that's here. I don't really think that's going to require action today, but after I did engage my brain, I talked to Sarah Jane Ellis, is the local projects coordinator for YDOT. She's actually our point person that we. She also, TAP is in her wheelhouse. And I called her, and so David Hurt is our area guy, and he actually happens to be in the area, and so Connie and I are going to meet with him this afternoon, maybe when he's coming through, just to explain how we would go about it. He thought that it would be a great thing to ask for to create a planning document. I think it would really help our case to the business council to say, here we have a plan that's how that's going to, instead of just talk, that you can say these things are, this is how this is all going to break out. So he said, yeah, and I asked him, I said, are we, some of those TAP things, you can't have a project going on and be eligible, but he said, just planning, you can actually have two. And he said, I don't think there's any issue where you know, the county hasn't really ever applied in a long time. And he thought that would be a great use. So anyway, he's going to come by and he's going to show Connie how to go about filling out the paperwork for a grant.
I'll say there is the statement of intent due by April 17th. So do we want to discuss this in the 21st meeting as well?
Yes. Yes, so after we meet with him and we see what's involved, then we want to go forward, you know. TAP meets, the commission meets in September, I think, usually in August, 1st of September, I go to Cheyenne and we meet, and then those funds are, we sort of develop a recommendation to YDOT commission and YDOT actually acts upon those. So that'd be this next year that we would be involved in the planning process up there.
How's the amount determined? Or is it just a set amount built?
For some reason, I'm thinking it's a set amount. I think it's $85,000, and I don't know if that's correct or if I remember correctly.
It says right here the fiscal year 2024, the project award maximum has been set at $1 million per project. Global match remains 9.51.
Yes, and that $1 million is for construction, construction projects, and I think the planning deal was 85,000. And then there's a 9% match to that. So
coming with all the paperwork.
Yeah. So anyway, I think that's a great opportunity to improve our application to the business council.
Oh, I agree.
And to say, you know, we have at least have this in the process.
If Sarah and David think that it's okay to have two consecutive planning projects open.
I didn't ask Sarah, but I did ask David that, and he said yes. He said the place when you get into trouble is if you had one open that was not going anywhere.
Mm.
But this one is progressing, and he's really pleased with the progression that's gone on in that. So he said, I don't see anything to cause you to be
the tricky thing with that is I'm pretty sure, based on my involvement with the Discovery Center planning grant, is they're coming up on their, I think it's been 2.5 years or 3 years that they've been working on that, they will probably apply for project money.
I don't think that the project money and the planning money here.
That's cool. I was just saying, if they apply for project money, they get awarded project money, then we have to wait if we want to apply for project money. I think having the master plan is really what we need right now, and maybe not right now. So
I don't see project money
through TAP, yeah.
through TAP for a while. Anyway. I mean, I think you're gonna have to get quite a little work to make sure that it's all there. So
when do you think they're gonna meet? When the TAP committee will meet?
They meet in usually in August. I'm sure the application has to be by something,
but there's an application that I don't want to be there.
Yeah. Anyway.
Mr. Chairman, can we have a recess for 5 minutes before we start the public hearing?
Yes, I agree.